So long as y'all know, look at some of the brothers looking. You scratching your head? I'm scratching mine too, man. It's like that. It's like that. Shit. Plus, I'm not even a novelty anymore. Shit, we all over TV. Caitlyn Jenner. RuPaul. And the biggest drag queen of all, Wendy Williams. Cause that nigga bigger than me. Let me tell y'all something. Y'all like, man, it's two camera guys in the back been buying me drinks since I got here thinking they was gonna get some pussy. They mad. Them white boys don't know. They can buy me drinks till Jesus come back. Ain't no pussy here. They've been slapping each other, giving each other high fives. We gonna run a train on this bitch. Fellas, I'm still with that train if y'all with it. Just know, nigga, this is an equal opportunity. If you hit me, then I hit you back, goddamn. Shit. But it's always some sister, some black bitch, TSA. Looking at the screen, telling everybody, come here, look, 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 that's the man. But the coward bitch always send a little Asian bitch running over there.
Oh, excuse me, ma'am, sir, sir, ma'am, sir, sir, ma'am.
I'm like, little bitch, get your pronouns together, I'll slap the shit out. Male or female pat down. So I always scan the room to see who looking. It's always some fine brother up in the cut, looking at a bitch laughing and shit. I say, excuse me, ma'am. Technically, I'm still a male. It's illegal for you to pat me down. Get that nigga. She gonna tell him, y'all. You can see him stomping and shit like, hey. He come over to me, I'm standing there. He say, man, this some bullshit. I say, do your job, player.
I went to Canada one time to do a show with what they call the Arctic Circle, which was dope, because we flew up there, but we like not like from the airport. Yeah, we flew from somebody's backyard. You know, he picked us up and he's like, yo, you know, he picked us up from the real airport, then took us to his house, and then said, we're gonna fly that way. And I'm like, well, when are we going back to the airport? He goes, that's the plane right there, my friend. And I was like, I thought that was a Corvette. Okay, you know what that is, right? Y'all speak English, right? Because no, it had a tarp over it, and we pulled the tarp off and it was an airplane, right? And you know what you don't want to hear before you get on a machine that can fly? Hand me the drill. I'm like, we got to put this together? And everybody's like, this is going to be great. And I was like, no. And I don't know if you ever flown on like a little plane like that. It's not like a regular plane where you just get on and sit on and find your seat. Mm-mm. You have to step on a scale. And I'm like, what's this for? He goes, well, we have to weigh you to see we're gonna sit on the plane and to determine how much fuel we're gonna put in it. And I was like, whoo. Cause it don't really matter how much I weigh, let's just fill it up. You know what I'm saying? And check it out, because my height, my weight, I had to sit right next to him like a co-pilot. Yeah. And we flying over the frozen tundra. Have you ever seen somebody do something that you don't know how to do, but you give him advice? Because something in you say, this motherfucker doing this wrong. Because we fly like this. Keep your foot on the pedal.
Yeah, hey, white people. No, y'all white people with that crazy ass. White people, you know, y'all crazy as hell. What I'm gonna need y'all to do when we go, when we at the airport, and we going through the TSA and it's time to get on the plane, I'm gonna need you to get to your seat and sit the fuck down. White people always wait to get to their seat to fold their coat, take out their laptop. Look here, Bob, sit the fuck down. Black people already don't wanna be on this motherfucker. Yeah. First time me and Tiffany and them went out, we get right up in the goddamn air, and the man said, oh, we gotta make an emergency landing, cause we ain't got no gas. I'm the only one on the plane, nigga! Fuck, you got me way up here and ain't got no gas. Crazy as hell.
We outside, y'all. It's a little, you know, right? Outside? Eh. We built it up. Built it up in our heads while we were inside, didn't we? A little overrated. A little exhausting, like I said. You know? They built it up. They lied to us. They said it was gonna be a bacchanal. That's what they were telling us. Gonna be the roaring 20s out this bitch. That's what they said. It's just variants and people fighting on planes and shit. Bus people on planes now. That's what's happening. It's bus people, the airlines was hurting during the quarantine. They say, yo, y'all wanna go to Cabo for $20 round trip? Bus people heated the car, packed up they fucking camo duffel bags and hit the skies, you know what I mean? And we all know what happens on Greyhound, so. Now it's happening at 30,000 feet. It's happening now, it's a drag.
I was in Austin, I was doing a festival, I was on the plane, I was on the phone with my girl and we're waiting to take off. And you know like the little sky waitress comes by and like puts you in an arm bar to get your phone out your hand? You know, I'd be extra about this shit. So I put the phone away, put it facing towards me, took my sweater off, put my seatbelt on, got situated, was living my best life, realized a phone call was coming in, reached for it, missed it, I was like, ah, shit. But it came from this girl I was messing around with before my girlfriend, but still within that 9 month, ugh. And this is exactly verbatim the voicemail she left me. Hey, Jack, I need you to call me back, like, right now. Oh, my God, shit. I never thought this was going to happen to me. Please, just call me back. Oh, my God, just call me now, please. I was like, shit. So I called her back immediately, but the plane starts to take off. And it sends so high that my phone call just dies. So I'm just in the air for 3 hours just being a father. And I go through, like, the full emotional range of that shit. That first hour when I really thought about it, I was like, I ain't raising them damn kids. I put a black in my mouth, like, hey, y'all, I'm an asshole. This is living my life from now on. That second hour, I marinated on it. I thought about it. I was like, I'm not going to be like my dad. I'm going to go stop by from time to time and teach that little nigga some cool handshakes and be like, yo, what's that over there? Then jump in an Uber. That third hour, I really sat with it. He's like, you know what I can't stand? The public school system in this country. It makes no fucking sense that we give all this money to the government, none of it goes to public schools, knowing damn well my baby in the drama department, she wanna dance. Let my baby dance! Plane lands. I call her 5 times. Answer the phone, answer the fucking phone. She's like, hey, I'm like, what the fuck is going on? She's like, oh, I just wanna let you know that I miss you. And I know I have a girlfriend now, but I wanna let you know how I feel about the situation. And I was like, I miss you too. And hung up the phone and texted her, don't you ever fucking call me again. I was home for the holidays. Most of y'all are young people, so you know exactly what I'm talking about. When you're a young person and you go home for the holidays, all you do is you sit there and defend your generation. That's all you fucking do is just get yelled at about your fucking generation. And I'm a young black dude. And I don't know if you know this, but there's a civil war going on between old black dudes and young black dudes. Old niggas hate us. Any older cousin, uncle, nigga named Darnell, they don't want nothing to do with us. I came home for Thanksgiving wearing pink socks. This nigga spit stuffing out. Why are all y'all gay? I was like, you just met my girlfriend, nigga. I don't even know how to answer that question. And it pisses me off that old niggas do that. He's like, why y'all act like that? Why y'all weird? Why y'all act like that? Why y'all weird? The government. The same way you acted weird when you were young, because of the government. The FBI wanted to destroy black men so we could never build equity in our communities, so they wanted us to be detached from our families, so they made economic obstacles, the prison system, flooded us with drugs, so subsequently it would lead to a generation of black men raised by their grandmas and their moms, just like me, creating a generation of sassy-ass niggas. Like, it blows my mind when old niggas are like, why y'all got pink dreads and face tattoos and dance so flamboyantly? Cause, nigga, Reagan. Ooh, 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 ooh. Like, you don't think Lil Uzi Vert was on the FBI's vision board? What the fuck are you talking about? Like, I be arguing with my girl, and we be going at it, but it's just like, you know what I mean? I don't know how to argue like my mama. My mama raised me, so I can see where it's like, man thing, woman thing, but we be up in there like, ting, 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 ting. Just full-on Love & Hip Hop reunion. Just nah-uh, throwing champagne till I finally admit that I kept watching Stranger Things when she went to work.
I remember I heard my mom and my dad trying to have a fight about my dad using crack. And my mom was trying to whisper, you know? So she was trying to have a whisper fight with the nigga, but you can't whisper to a crackhead. They're loud as fuck. So my mom's whispering, and then my dad goes, "Who seen me do the crack?" Which means, nigga, you did it. Now you're just trying to identify witnesses. Are they credible? Are they not credible? But you fucking did it. Now I'm gonna tell my mom about a problem. Bitch, there's whole crack in the house. We got bigger issues. Stranger Things is a whole show about kids not trusting their parents. Like, if a demigod's after you, tell your mom. These little niggas are like, nah, all I got is these walkie-talkies and these bikes. And my best friends. Because that bitch can't handle shit. White people still, I don't know. Like, y'all preparing for some shit, but y'all won't tell us what it is. Y'all move so weird, man. Y'all actions are weird. Y'all getting ready, and the world's ending. Everything's burning, we get it, and y'all preparing. And just tell us. Tell us what's happening. Stop keeping the shit to yourself. They do weird shit. They just get lost in the woods for no reason. Let's just follow the North Star out. Bitch, why? Doing tough mutters and shit, just running through the mud, just running, why? But then when you think about it, like, when the mudslides hit, them niggas gonna be moving. Niggas, on the other hand, we're fucked. We prepare for nothing. We have no plan for the end of the world, and it's clear it's happening. All we're gonna do is meet in Atlanta. That's niggas' plan, just meet in Atlanta. There's gonna be a bunch of niggas in front of a Waffle House, like, well, I assume this was the spot, and then we talk about what's next. Thought we get together first. What I wanna know is who's cooking? Who's doing the cooking this whole time? Jesus.
I'm not from Atlanta, I live in New York. And I was in New York, and I was waiting for the elevator, right? And the elevator comes, there's only one person on the elevator. It's this old white woman. Just the first white woman. Eve is on the elevator. And so I step onto the elevator door's closed behind me. Eve looks up at me, and she immediately grabs her purse tighter. Right? And I was like, wow, that's crazy that, like, even now, there's still old people who don't know how elevator works. Because even if it was my plan to steal her purse, I would have been like... this thing. You know what I mean? So what do I do? You know, there's only three floors of this elevator. I'm not gonna yell at an old lady, but she just did this weird thing. I feel weird in my head. I'm like, what do I do? So I farted on her. And like, it was a quiet one. It was It was as silent and subtle as her racism. It was... Neither one of us got off that elevator happy. We were both very upset.
I fall all the time. I was just on a set of another movie. The last like line of the last scene, like the last week, was a very long week. And I turned around after I said my line. I didn't see the camera. The camera was so close that I headbutted it. That's how close the camera was. No, truly, like I said my line, I was like, okay, everybody have a good night. And I turned around and I hit that shit so hard, it looked like I did it on purpose. Like I hit it and I was like, ow, karma, why you hit me so hard? And I was about to fall down, and this is something that happens in your 40s that nobody tells you. You think about how you're gonna fall. You think about how you're gonna fall. I said, girl, how you gonna fall? I said, I don't know, girl. I said, girl, we gonna fall on face? And I'm like, no, girl. You're gonna chip your tooth. And a chip tooth, freckles, and big titties? That's too much character. We don't need all that character. So I was like, girl, what are we gonna do? We gonna fall on our hands? You just wanna fall on your hands. That's the most natural reaction. Stop! Stop the fall, stop! You better stop this fall. And then I said, no, girl, don't fall on your hands. You gonna break your wrist. If you break your wrist, who gonna wipe your ass? I know you guys are thinking I'm making so much money in this borrowed gold sequence plus size suit. But I don't have ass wiping money, okay? Yet, I got goals. My ass. My husband, I love him. He loved me. He ain't gonna wipe my ass. He is not gonna wipe my ass, okay? I can't even fart in front of my husband. And it's not up to him, it's up to me. I don't wanna fart in front of him. We've been married 10 years. It's lovely. I'm not gonna fart in front of him. No. Uh-uh. Would you eat in a restaurant that's dirty?
I do not know what people think goes on in an interracial marriage. We argue like any other couple argues. The only thing I've learned is what we've learned and how to argue as a couple, what we learned growing up with our families. Now, see, in my family, if we have a problem with you, we're gonna let you know. It might get ugly. We might yell and scream, but we'll make up eventually. In his family, if they have a problem with you, you may never know. You might read a vague Facebook post or some shit like that. Is this shit about me? So we had our first big blowout argument, right? And I couldn't help it. I was angry. It came out before I could stop myself, and I called my husband a motherfucker. And it came out like I really meant it. And he stopped me. He said, uh-uh, we're not gonna argue like that. He said, babe, you can yell, you can scream, but we're not gonna call each other names like that. I said, come on, babe. You mean to tell me that your parents didn't have big arguments and they said things to each other in the heat of the moment that they didn't mean because they were just that angry? He said, no. The worst thing I ever heard my parents say to each other is one time my mom called my dad ridiculous. I said, y'all some ridiculous motherfuckers, because I ain't never heard no shit like that in my life. My father-in-law all, he tries to connect with me by being funny. Well, he thinks he's funny, right? We all have that relative that thinks they're so funny in the family, but they're just inappropriate. We go to get ready to go out for dinner, and I go to sit in the back of the family van. Uh-huh. I'm gonna say that again. I go to sit in the back of the family van. My father-in-law says, Tracey, you don't have to sit in the back of the van. Civil rights made it so you can sit out front. And he is dying laughing, y'all. He's slapping his legs. He's reeling back. He's killing himself. And I'm thinking to myself, my father-in-law is trying to connect with me by making racist-ass jokes. And he has a million of these bits. I feel like he's been sitting on these bits for years. And he asked his son, when you gonna bring home a black girl? Because I got some jokes.
But I do like fucking white dudes. I like to fuck them so hard their ancestors cry. I got another one. I love fucking white dudes. Ooh, I love it. But I have to be careful, because I like rough sex, and there's a right way to get tied up and a wrong way. The feeling of privilege inside of me. I'm kidding. I don't only fuck white dudes. I raised my pussy to not see color.
And at the beginning of the year, I had a show up in Boston. It went great. Feeling good about myself after the show, I hopped into an Uber, and the driver says to me, he goes, ma'am, where am I taking you tonight? And I said, oh, just back to my hotel. And he said, you stay in there or do you live there? And I was like, I'm just staying there. You understand how hotels work, right? Then he said, ah, so it's more like a shelter then. Got it. Oh. Right? Exactly. And then he goes, hey, a home is a home. Even though it's a shelter, it's your home, right? And I was like, dude, not right. It's not my home or shelter. It's a hotel, like I just told you. And look, I don't know how many of you guys have ever been out feeling good about yourself and you thought you looked pretty nice and then someone just proclaimed you homeless. Like, I don't know how often that happens to y'all. It was my first time. I didn't love it. But I remember thinking, Erin, don't get upset. This man drives an Uber, right? Which means he probably knows this area. And maybe there's a shelter right next to your hotel and you didn't even notice. Maybe it's even next door. And the pin drop is so close to where you're going, he couldn't decipher, because he wasn't being a jerk about it, right? He was wanting me to feel good about my situation. He was like, it's still your home. Like, it was like a motivational Uber. Anyway, so we get back to the hotel, and I walk in, and I'm about to go up to my room, but now I'm curious, right? I want to know if my hypothesis about the shelter was right. So I asked the lady at the front desk. I said, excuse me, ma'am, is there a shelter near here, like a homeless shelter in this general area? And she looked at me, and she was like, do you need a place to stay the night? I was like, no, I do not. I'm staying here. You just watched me let myself into your hotel with the key. I'm going up to my room now to burn this outfit, I think, in a trash can, because you know how we do. So anyway, I get back home. I'm telling that story a couple weeks ago, and this young girl comes up to me after the show. She walks up to me, and she goes, you know, you should really stop saying homeless. That word is offensive. The politically correct term is unhoused, okay? Because homeless implies that people are less because they don't have homes. And I said, no, that's not how suffixes work. The less just means without. It's not an insult, it's just English.
Now, let me explain something to you about my Uncle Cecil. My Uncle Cecil suffered from seizures, he was crippled, and he was also retarded. Now calm the fuck down and let me tell you why I use the word retarded. He was born in 1932. There was no special need back then. He was fucking retarded, okay? So Atlanta, I'm gonna need you to open your mind with me on this one, okay? So my uncle would have 2-3 seizures a week, y'all. And my granddaddy got tired of that shit, so he came up with this good idea. He thought if he bought my uncle pussy every Saturday, it would calm down the amount of seizures that he would have during the week. Come on, y'all, don't cop block on my Uncle Cecil. He need love too. So every Saturday, no lie, it was me and my sister chores. We had to go in there and help him get started. Shut the fuck up, this is my story and I'm gonna tell it. We would walk in the room, y'all, and the prostitute would already be in the bed with a whole Jackson 5 afro on a vagina. Open your mind and you can see it. Like, how you doing today, Miss Betty? We about to get him ready for you. My uncle be over there in the corner smiling like a motherfucker. We walk up to him, he always had on two belts, cause at any time this nigga would have $50 worth of nickels in his pocket. We would take them pants off, y'all, and no lie, they would hit the floor sound like you're working on a chain gang. And no lie, my uncle dick would pop out. He had the biggest uncircumcised dick I ever seen in my life. That he could not control. And a lot of time that extra skin would hit me and my sister upside the head. Be like, hold on, Uncle Cecil, your tip dry, nigga. So we would walk him over to the bed cause he was crippled, right? And by him being crippled, to me, he looked like he walked like a kangaroo. This story is not gonna send you to hell, baby. And we would throw him in the bed on top of the prostitute, y'all, because you know he can't get on his knees like regular people can, because if he do, he gonna look like Free Willy from the back. So me and my sister would get on each end of the bed while he laid on top of the prostitute. We would grab him by his ankle and we would yank his legs apart. And no lie, y'all, the dick would go straight up in the prostitute. But since he was retarded, we had to motivate him, right? So we started screaming, kangaroo that pussy Uncle Cecil! About 3-4 pumps in, we go tell Granddad, he back there kangaroo in the pussy. Can we get our 50 cents so we can go play Pac-Man now? But I gotta keep it real to y'all. That shit did not help my uncle with his seizures.